Let's start with this session about inclusive cities. Warm welcome to everyone, to the audience, and of course to our guests, to our speaker. The idea is to discuss the challenges of local governments, that local governments are facing in order to build inclusive cities. Building inclusive cities, I think, can be seen as a moral as well as an economic imperative. Moral because it's important to advance human dignity, and economic because we need to explore the creative potential of the citizen, of everyone living in a big city or in a small city. And there are also a lot of reports from the OECD and other organizations that shown us that productive, that inclusive cities are also productive cities. And in 2015, which is tomorrow, 2050, sorry, two-thirds of the world population are expected to live in cities, 70%. That means that you, local governments, are turning to be major players when it comes to generate democratic, cohesive, inclusive society. And societies that ensures the development of human rights, of innovation, access to inclusive institutions, development, culture. So you are in control of a variety of policy instruments, and we will talk during that session about how do you use these policy instruments and what priority do you have in going towards a more inclusive city. There are also a lot of challenges that you face to get your city more inclusive, challenges that comes from inequality, that comes from environment, from a lot of things that may be obstacles to this long-term goal of inclusive city. So we would like to talk, we'd like to hear your experiences, and we would like to hear how do you deal with their challenges. And I'm very, very happy to introduce and to present to you two mayors from very, very different cities. They cannot be more different. I will start with Katrin. Katrin Stjernfeld-Diame. I hope I did
right.
pronounce your...
That's
yes.
That's correct.
You are the mayor of Malmö in Sweden, which is the third largest city in Sweden. 300,000 people, mm-hmm. roughly.
Yeah. Yeah. We're the third largest city in Sweden. We're not that big, but we have about 179 different nationalities. And the city is quite young, with 40% younger than 29 years old.
Mm-hmm. And at your right side, so the mayor of Mexico City, Miguel Ángel Mancera. A very warm welcome.
Thank you very much.
You are representing 20 million people.
More or less.
Incredible.
Exactly. So many.
More than some countries.
Así es.
Indeed. There are 20 million people living in Mexico City, 5.5 million cars, approximately 13 million kilometers of drinking water networks, 12,000 kilometers of sanitation networks, and 1,500 square kilometers of the city's surface area, approximately, in a nutshell.
Different challenges to govern those cities. I will also introduce and give a warm welcome to Lamia Kamal Shawi, your senior advisor to the Secretary General here at the OECD. And you will now give us a short overview about our topic and explain why it is so important to fight for inclusive growth in the city.
Thank you very much, Achim. Do we have the slide? Not yet. Can we launch the PowerPoint? Okay. Mayor Mancera, Mayor Jamay, I'm delighted to be here today with you to set the scene for this session on inclusive cities. Since 2012, the OECD has helped put inclusive course at the heart of the global policy agenda. And as our discussion today will make it clear, cities must be at the heart of this global policy agenda. Just this morning, President Bachelet, who is the chair of the MCM, the ministerial meeting, that we are now, we have started, you know that they have started just in the room next to this one. In her opening remarks, she said she highlighted three very important key areas if we want to increase productivity to achieve a more inclusive society. She said that we need to prepare people for work in the future. The second area that she stressed is to ensure a level playing field. And the third one is to build cities as a platform of innovation and social inclusion. So we can see that now there is a growing recognition by the central government about the key role that cities have to play to meet all of our global challenges. So in 2012, the OECD launched the Inclusive Growth Initiative as the corporate response to rising inequalities. The initiative has provided decision makers across the world with the data and tools to promote fairer and more prosperous societies, working with a range of stakeholders, policymakers, prominent experts and foundations, especially the Ford Foundation. We have helped to set the inclusive growth agenda in many countries, but also within key international fora like the G20. We have delivered a flagship report, including the All on Board Making Inclusive Growth Happen, and I'm going to show you the reports because then you can take them in the library, which is over there. This is the first one that we produced 2 years ago. And that one, which the name is the Productivity Inclusiveness Report, is the one that was presented yesterday during the first day of the forum, and actually is being discussed right now by Minister in the next room. So, So rising inequalities, as you can see on the screen, has become one of the defining challenges of our time. The OECD has long been documenting these trends. We have produced in 2008 a first report which sent a very strong alarm. The name of the report was Growing Unequal. In 2011, we produced another report called Divided We Stand. And in 2015, just last year, we produced that one in it together, Why Less Inequality Benefit to All. And actually, during this period of time, we have really showed that inequalities have been rising without any stop. And then let me give you one data. In the OECD, the average income of the richest 10% has grown to 10 times that of the poorest. That represents an increase up to, it was 7 during the mid-80s, which represent actually, it was this period, the 30 years of time. This is an increase of about 40% in just one generation. The slide on the screen, as you can see, show the evolution of one of the most commonly measure of inequality, which is the Gini index that most of you may know. And we can clearly see that the gap between the rich and poor has increased in most OECD countries. We can see also that in emerging market economies, inequalities have either increased or decreased during this period of time, but still they remain at extraordinary level, very high level. And let me give you an example. We have the mayor of Mexico City here. In Mexico, the ratio between the richest 10% and the poorest 10% stands at approximately 30 to 1. In Brazil, it stands at 50 to 1. And in South Africa, it is now over 100 to 1. What is really surprising is that income inequality has also increased in traditionally egalitarian countries like Sweden, Germany, the Netherlands, Denmark, although we need to be cautious about this because the level remained quite comparatively low, but still the trend was that inequalities have increased. The inequality in wealth, we have also recently documented inequalities in wealth, and they are even more striking. This can only exacerbate the overall disadvantage of the low-income households. But inequality is not just a question of money, it's not just a question of income. Inequality is also felt in labor market exclusion, lower social mobility, and greater polarization in educational and health outcome. For instance, let me give you data. We took a group of 40 countries and we found out that on average, people with higher level of education, they can live 6 years longer than their poorly educated peers. But these data, they also show something, is that this trend is not something that came with the crisis, because everybody was talking about this phenomenon during the crisis. It was only exacerbated by the crisis. These trends date back to a very long time ago. It was 30 years ago we have started to identify this very worrying trend. And actually, this has happened during a period of strong and sustained economic growth. We also provided mounting evidence, not just the OECD, but the IMF and other international institutions and also research centers. They provided mounting evidence that actually inequalities over time tend to harm economic growth. This, of course, we know that it can generate social instability and sometimes political instability. So one thing that have become evident in our work on inclusive growth is that inequalities have an inherent special dimension. Cities in particular may generate growth and economic opportunity, but they also concentrate inequalities. And OECD work has shown that in many countries, income inequalities in cities has been rising faster than the overall income inequalities in countries, primarily due to skills distribution and the capturing of top earners. The top earners tend to live in cities, and cities tend to attract the more skilled part of the population. Emerging evidence suggests that inequalities increase with city size. In other words, let's say that this has become a major issue in our largest and often our wealthiest metropolitan region. This is well illustrated in this graph on the slide, where we can observe a trend of higher level of inequalities in larger cities. Actually, we are currently working to produce the Gini index for metropolitan region with 1.5 million inhabitants and more, and the preliminary result confirmed this trend. We have with us in the room two of the key authors of this forthcoming books, Monica Brezzi and Soojin Kim, who are preparing a report making inclusive growth happen, and actually most of the data come from their work. Another thing that they are also doing is that as part of the inclusive growth initiative, we have also produced something, a new metric. The new metric that goes beyond income that tends to take into account other non-monetary dimension like education, employment and health, and inequalities. We call it the multidimensional living standards. We have produced that for all the countries. And our colleagues now, they are also trying to develop and produce this data for metropolitan regions. So very, very soon, we will have very, very, very good data to illustrate all these very important trends. So where you live actually can influence how long you live, your chance of getting a job, your access to health and services, and finally, your overall social mobility. For instance, in the United States, I give you a very appealing data, life expectancy varies by 6 years across US states. In Mexico, people living the worst off state are 4 times poorer, would likely die 4 years younger, will be 7 times more likely to abandon schooling, and 3 times more likely to feel unsafe in their cities compared to those living in the best performing state. Disadvantaged areas in cities are often home to poorer housing conditions, lower level of access to services, and lower quality scores. And again, mounting evidence suggests that poverty and inequality tend to be reproduced across generation. Here we have a graph on the screen which show that, for instance, in the Netherlands, people living in the poorest neighborhoods are likely to earn on average around 6% less than as adults than those who have lived in these wealthier areas. And here I'm talking about one of the most egalitarian countries. If we do the same exercise in those countries which have very strong disparities, I think we will have more striking data for that. So city and regional governments, they are critical actors in the policy domain that matter for inclusive growth. Subnational governments at the OECD, they are responsible for 40% of total public spending, and they have most often responsibility in such areas like housing, transport, education, labor market integration, infrastructure investment, and public services. So they are also the place where we can observe the most innovative and effective solutions. So we will agree that if we want to win the battle against inequalities, we need to take action, but we have to ensure that mayors are at the heart of the fight. And actually, they are. Many mayors across the world, they have already made inclusive growth a central pillar of their policy agenda. I give you an example. Just two months ago, we launched in New York the Inclusive Growth in Cities campaign in the presence of Mayor de Blasio of New York and 20 other mayors from all around the world. We launched this campaign. It's a kind of global coalition of champion mayors for inclusive growth. And to date, we have 50 champion mayors who have answered to this call to join the campaign. I'm delighted that we have the mayor of Mexico City, who is one of our founding mayors, who joined the campaign from the beginning, and we hope that the mayor of Malmo will join the coalition. So by joining this campaign, actually what they did, they signed on the New York proposal. Oh, maybe I went too far. They signed on something called the New York proposal for inclusive growth. Here we have, it's being distributed there, the proceeding of the New York meeting, where you have the New York proposal. In any case, if you Google New York proposal, Inclusive Growth in Cities campaign, you will find it. So what is this? This is a document that sets out a common commitment to a policy agenda to ensure that all cities work for all. And all the signatory mayors, actually, by signing on this proposal, they have committed to champion an inclusive growth agenda in their city, their country, and all around the world. They are kind of ambassadors of inclusive growth. They have committed to participate actively in the global campaign, including by sharing best practices and policy tools, and to advance a policy agenda around the four following premises. One is to provide inclusive education and training system. The second one is to promote inclusive labor market. The third one is to promote inclusive housing systems. And the fourth one is about public services and infrastructure, including transport. So what next? We will continue to consolidate the campaign. We will continue to define common measurement tools, compare results, and share best practices in all this policy domain that I have mentioned. And we will create kind of platform, an online platform, where these mayors can share their best practices. We are working hand in hand with the most important international association of local government in the world, who are partnering this initiative. And mayors will reconvene in Paris in November, hosted by Mayor Hidalgo, the mayor of Paris. In New York, we produced the New York proposal. So now we're going to produce the Paris Action Plan, working in collaboration with the city government of these 50 champion mayors. So in anticipation of this important step in our work, I would like to close by recognizing that two mayors on the panel who are helping to lead this global effort. I'm thinking about Mexico City cross-cutting agenda to build a more inclusive metropolitan areas. I'm thinking about what the mayor is doing in the area of public health. So I know he's going to talk about that, Medico in Tu Casa, but also all the work that they have been doing to improve investment in mass transport, the ongoing discussion for the new constitution of Mexico City. I'm also thinking about what Malmo is going to tell us, and we were having lunch today. We were talking about this very important issue of integration of refugees, the fact that Malmo is the first recipient of refugees coming to Sweden, and that the local government has to, they are the first that had to confront these new challenges. So thank you very much, and I am very much looking forward to hearing from you and the audience. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lamia. Before I will take the first question from the audience, I will just remind you that you can ask questions and have comments on different ways. You can raise your hand, which is the most simple way. You can also connect you to the OECD application YAssembly and participate directly in this session. And you can also send us questions via Twitter. You have to do it with the hashtag OECD Green, because we are here in the, as you can see, the green room. So don't hesitate, ask questions, give us your comments, your feelings.
She has something to say.
Okay.
Give me that. I will have the announcement. Okay. So there is a poll. There is a pool, and on your chair you will find a flyer which explains how to play.
So the question is the following. Do you believe you already live in an inclusive city? Yes, no, and sure. So please try start to vote now, and we will have the result later on. Did I do that right?
Correct.
Thank you.
Yes, you can vote now, or maybe you can take some time following a little bit of our discussion, and we will give you the results just before the end of our debate, so we can have your reaction to the results and also, of course, the reaction of our mayors. I would like to start with you, Mayor Mancera, because you did a lot of it's been 2.5 years that you're in office now. You did a lot of things in the social area. I would like to tell us a little bit about this action that you undertook in order to foster inclusive growth in Mexico.
Bien, cómo no.
Of course. I think telling you about these mechanisms and this challenge of achieving an inclusive city is complex, especially when we have such a big population as the population of Mexico City. But I'd like to tell you about two measures we've taken today. First of all, we focused on raising the minimum wage, and we have done this in Mexico City, and we have noted that our country is lagging approximately 30 years behind since we haven't been raising the minimum wage, and our economy has been focused on combating inflation by working on the leeway given by not raising the minimum wage. And Mexico is a country which its productivity is comparable to Chile's, but the gap between the Chilean minimum wage and the Mexican minimum wage is huge. And trade unions' resistance to breaking up these rules was amazing. I had all of the businesses and all of the trade unions up in arms against me because they said I was going to set off inflation throughout the country. But we have demonstrated the fact that and we have a constitutional reform to do this, that we will be able to do this. And this has an impact on 7.5 million people. So how can we have an inclusive city if we are still making 7.5 million of our inhabitants live below the poverty line? And that's the food poverty line. We believe that this is not worthy of a country that is deeply concerned about the well-being of its population. And this is just some of what we're doing. Mexico City launched the initiative of bringing the minimum wage up and carrying out a constitutional reform. And we have been able to do that. We have been successful. And so now we are moving on towards raising the minimum wage and bringing up all of people's incomes. The second thing we have done is that we noticed that our population had major health issues. Some were focused on more marginal populations, for instance, refugees or populations that are vulnerable and have no access to health care. And even if you have the best hospital, this population will never make it to the hospital. So what Mexico City does was launch a campaign called El Médico en tu Casa, having a doctor at home, meaning we were sending doctors to people's homes to do checkups and to give prescriptions for drugs. And this revealed that we had a very high percentage of pregnant young women who were not being followed by a physician during their pregnancy. And at least now we are achieving a 6 to 7% medical rate for pregnant women. We had elderly people, we had people in terminal phases of diseases, and we had people with disability who had no possibility of reaching a hospital because they had no means of transportation to get there. So we set up brigades, and these brigades gathered people, and 1 year down the road now, we have had 2.3 million homes that have been visited by doctors, and that allowed us to determine what were the major health issues in Mexico City's population. For instance, there was a high prevalence of hypertension, of high blood pressure, high a percentage of diabetes, but we made sure that our healthcare system is reaching out to the people who really need it, meaning we established an inclusive mechanism. And I was thinking, and I'll try to be brief so that the mayor of Malmo can take the floor, but if we start from the people who have the least and we make sure that cities can include these people with the services we have, then that will be a major achievement. Because when we include this inequality, it just becomes part of our landscape. You showed a picture of an underdeveloped and a developed urban landscape. And this is part of the same city. These aren't two different cities. It is just part of our daily landscape, and it doesn't matter to us anymore. And this is what we have to change. And one of the major issues we've had is that the big research and support funds are provided to the country, but not to cities. So when cities want to take measures, they do not have the means to do so. Today, people are saying that Mexico City has a major pollution issue. We are the 541st city at the world level. But the federal authority changed the metrics, and what used to be a clean day for us is now a polluted day. And we need to take measures, but we need funds to do that. And the funds aren't within the city. They're at the other level of government, and we don't know what they're being used for. So we think this is a serious issue cities have, because cities are making the decisions, and sometimes these aren't popular decisions. These aren't vote-earning decisions. When it means changing people's lifestyles, people get upset. But I was reading things about climate change and about what France is going through because of the heavy rain. And I think these are things that have to be done. If we want an inclusive society, and that's what was mentioned as an introduction here, we need to focus on the environment, we need to focus on health, and we need to focus on social well-being for the population.
Yeah, Mancera, I think you're right with that idea of you have to have a kind of holistic approach to implement measures towards inclusive city. And I would like to know from our mayor of Malmö, Katrin Stjernfeld, Jamme, you are in office since 2 years, right? What are your principal action that you took just right after coming to office to foster inclusion in your city?
First of all, I would say that I became a deputy mayor responsible for social welfare in 2008, before I became the mayor. And the first thing was to launch a different way of working with the public health. And at that time, 2008, the World Health Organization launched a report urging all nations worldwide to work with inequality in health in a different way. And we decided to start on a very local level, to launch a commission like that on the local level. And they've been working for 2 years to come out with suggestions and strategic plans for the city council to work with. And it's a really holistic approach. 14 commissioners with different backgrounds, city planners, expert in education, experts in social welfare, for example. And together, they worked very hard in 2 years' time, and they included like 2,000 people in different way to work with this suggestions for the city council. And since then, we have been working hard to implement this focus of equality in health in all our different parts of the organization. And I think the most important thing is to include different parts of society, like the NGOs in the society, the business organization, and I can feel that you have lots of people that in different way would like to make the city more equal and to make sure that people have the access for the labor market, for example, and have the chance to live their life in health. So today we have a focus. We have been working quite a long time with sustainability when it comes to environment, and when we build new parts of the city, we have a very close focus working together with the businesses. And now we try to work in a similar way with a focus to create equality in health. And then I think it's important to see that on the local agenda, we work with the educational system. We have to make sure that all children in our city have the access to the education that open up the doors for the labor market in the future. And we have a special focus on economic and social security, but also on democracy and inclusiveness, to make sure that you feel that you're part of the city. It's not just the neighborhood that belongs to you, but you're owner of the city and in general, and you can feel free to take part of all social services. And we would like all young people that grow up or young people that move to our city to feel that are as important as everyone else. So now we try to work in our normal organization to make sure that they implement the strategical ideas about social investments and to include different perspectives in decision making, for example.
Thank you very much. I've just maybe one following question before asking the audience to participate, because yes, inclusive cities and inclusive debate, of course. What can you tell us roughly what is your budget for inclusive policy? If you would like maybe give us a slight idea of the percentage of the budget that you spend on inclusive policies.
I think that's hard to say, actually, because I think all our budget in the municipality, I mean, since I want all parts in our organization to work with this inclusive ambitions, I think everything we do has to be with the focus on inclusiveness. So I think the whole budget, it depends on how you defines it, but I think everything, actually.
Would you agree with
we
that?
We use 60% of the budget for that kind, 60%. More or less, pardon, más o menos.
We would be at about 60% of the budget for Mexico City. I'll try to express it in dollars. 160 billion would be, well, about, let me try and work it out in US dollars. 110 million US dollars. That would be about it. Which are devoted only to the social sector. Mexico City has an allowance for senior citizens, and a good part of the budget goes into that. Then we have measures for the handicap, for job creation, for the startups. So it's split up into different sectors. But that has also avoided violence in Mexico City because we managed to set up this social network. Nevertheless, we continue working at these cities and building them because we wonder how is it possible that in certain states of Mexico there's more violence than in others. Well, because the best hospitals are concentrated in the urban cities, because cities have best services, and all those who live outside cities don't. And a doctor at home, that is a program which already is implemented in about 8 cities. We work together with other countries as well, with Bogota and Medellin and with Chile, for example, because we think that everybody should have access to these services, and this is not the case. Does that mean that part of the city budget goes into this? Not necessarily, because research centers have joined us, universities, and those funds which are sometimes slumbering there but don't get where they should go. And I think they could be used in a better way, particularly for prevention. We tend to react. We wait for the problem to happen, and then we try and find a solution for it. But prevention, alert, climate change, epidemics, all that is latent in a city, and there we can take measures, preventive measures. But they should be a bottom-up. That is what inclusive cities are all about.
Are there any questions? Yes. Do we have a micro? Yes. Can you present yourself briefly? Yes. And then?
Yes.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Eric Azdrubal Salas from Mexico. I'm coming from the Business Chamber of Mexico. It's called Coparmex. And I would like to say the question in Spanish. Perhaps Mr. Mancera feel more comfortable with it. I hope you don't mind. Señor Mancera, un gusto estar aquí.
It's a pleasure to be here with you. Good afternoon, Mr. Mancera. Very interesting what you told us. I have a question to you. How do you envisage Mexico City in about 25 years? How do you see it? And what would you say would be the biggest hindrance in the way of making this vision true? Thank you for your question. I'll try to put this in context. Since Mexico City was created, it's been spreading out. First, it was 5 square kilometers, and it was spreading out more and more. Initially, it looked like would do this like any other city, but in some time of its history, like in the 80s of the last century, it expanded a lot, and not like Paris, which grew, but in a planned way. Mexico City grew and expanded, but without any urban planning. Now, someone thought maybe it would be a good idea to ask people not to build within the city anymore and to move out of the city. So now we have commuters who come to work in the city, but they live 2 hours away, which means a lot of traffic, transport problems, and health problems as well, of course. So what are we trying to achieve? We want to create a compact city with different centers, multi-centric. And what I would like very much if Mexico City would get together anymore, if these people who moved so far away would be able to come back, it would make for quality of life for everybody. And what would be an obstacle on this way? Well, political matters for once. Because if someone came and decided the opposite, if it was decided that this policy was wrong, that we shouldn't build within Mexico City, but should, again, move everybody out of the city, the same, we would fall back into the same problems. And what is the risk? It's easy to sell. What is much more difficult to try and fight against what we think was not done correctly. We don't have enough green spaces. For the moment, we have 60%. We should be a very, very green city, but it didn't happen because the city spread out and expanded all around. Normally, cities have one broad infrastructure, and there the best developments take place, not necessarily in the outskirts. And that is not exactly what happened. But I can imagine a city which is more and more modern. We are changing things now. We don't want any more taxes, neither gasoline nor petrol, only hybrid or electric cars. But, well, we're talking about 140,000 taxis working in Mexico City. So we're only starting with this. And we have to fight for it against the unions, against the taxi associations. We want a green city, an environmentally aware city. And I would like to see Mexico City more compact and more together. Many different bodies participate in this initiative, civil society, enterprise, and we are turning more and more towards civil society. They have very good ideas. The mayor of Malmo told us about this as they set up this commission with different expertise.
I would like to take one question from our internet audience, from our followers. There are a lot of interesting questions. We should have maybe 2 hours more for our discussion. But I think this could be a question for you, Katrin, because there's one follower that one follower is asking, shouldn't we rethink public spaces as a means to promote intergenerational and intercultural dialogue? And I was thinking of Malmö because you have the challenges with the immigrants and the refugees, and I think intercultural dialogue must be one of your priorities in your political action, right?
Yeah, right. I think to have a dialogue with all the citizens with different backgrounds is important. And when we do our city plan, we involve approximately 50,000 people were engaged in some way during the last process with the city plan. And it was like citizens, organizations, different businesses taking part of this city planning. And when we discuss how to develop the city center in different areas of the cities, we try to invite different different groups. For example, we invited young girls in one of our areas to be part of planning of new meeting places, to create something that we didn't have before. And they were working with their networks to make sure that people who wasn't normally in decision making areas, that they were actually taking part of this. And of course you have to find different ways of doing this different dialogues. But I think it's an important part of city planning if you mean to be very inclusive when you grow fast. And we do that at the moment.
As Lamia pointed out in her presentation, Malmö received a tremendous amount of refugees last year. How do you deal with that?
I think Sweden was one of the countries in the European Union that actually had lots most immigrants per capita per inhabitants, and lots of them were coming through Malmö, and we know the track record is that lots of people would like to come back to Malmö when they've arrived to Sweden, and I think that's not strange that refugees who settle down in Sweden would like to go to the cities where you have people from your own country, you have different meeting places with people with the same background as you. But we have to find solutions to make this sustainable when it comes to schooling, when it comes to new housings and things like that. And of course, we struggle quite a lot at the local level to find good solutions. And we have a debate with the government, the national government, how to make the solutions sustainable. And for me, it has to be like all European countries take the same kind of responsibility. And with the same logic, it means that all municipalities in Sweden has to take part actively to make sure that we have schools, housings, and so on, to make sure that people have a good introduction that create growth in the long run. And we have some cities that are growing faster than others. We have some cities that has been struggling for years, that they're actually becoming less and less people. And now we have a chance to work together to make this sustainable. In my everyday life, when we plan the city to make sure that you have good living conditions, we work with the whole labor market, including much more people than just the city of Malmö, of course. We're really close to Copenhagen. We have a labor market with 4 million inhabitants. So I think it's important that we work together with the universities, with the local businesses, to make sure that the new refugees have a chance to be part of the labor market much, much quicker than today.
So you would see the refugees and the newcomers, the new immigrants, rather as an asset than a cost?
I mean, if you handle it in a correct way, you create possibilities to make people part of the society quite fast. But if you have lots of people come to the same areas and you don't manage to offer schools that can meet the needs, or if you don't have the housings enough, then you create social problems that's hard to tackle in the long run. So it's important that you have possibilities to settle down quick, and that you have an educational system adjustable for the new premises.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Are there any questions? I think you raised your hand the first. Yeah. The gentleman, the first lane. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I believe in education, and in 2015 we launched a service called Quipper School in your country, Mexico. And because there was a huge demand, it's an online video tutorial service. Now, up until now, at over 10,000 teachers with 50,000 students in Mexico use our service, and we operate in 3 countries in the world with over 5 million users. And Dr. Miguel, what's your view on the education, and what kind of educational policies are you thinking to do in terms of inclusive cities?
Ese es otro tema bien importante.
Well, that's a very important subject. In Mexico, education is changing. Laws applying to education are changing. For once, we are saying quite clearly that teachers have to be trained. What can we do about this in Mexico City? We were excluded of this because we weren't an autonomous city. We are part of a department or a region depending on the national government. So I think that teachers have to be entitled to training, and then all our young people have to be included. We have a problem. Youngsters feel rejected because they don't really have serious chances to train. And even if they train and if they go to school, they're not sure they'll find a job. So they prefer to let go another year, to wait for a year to see whether well-known universities will accept them. So this year we launched an initiative which we call No Rejected Youngsters. That would mean that we have to make an effort to give everybody a chance. And before they finish school, they should know what their options are. They should know that they have about 500,000 opportunities. If we have many young people who come to higher educational level, 350,000 about, now we're really working for them to try and get them settled. First, they need vocational training, and then they have to be included, which means that big universities have to work with us. Because a citizen who has not enough money could never, ever get to Harvard. So what can we do to bring those services to those who have less? We don't tend to think of them at all. They're there. They live in the same place. They live with us, like the homeless, in fact. They live in the city, but no one cares for it. They're sort of part of the picture. What can we do to achieve that? These people get access to a system or to a service. And the same goes for education. If there is a youngster who has no money, will he have no opportunity because the universities are first world universities? How can such universities be included in a system, in a framework, in a platform? Why not? I'm very interested, actually, in that program. They feel these youngsters can train, can study, and even online, in fact. Yes, even online. They don't actually have to go there. It's not a matter of money. It's a matter of having the will. And I think universities are very well disposed to participate, because otherwise what will happen? That all these migrants in European countries, that all those who are excluded in the American countries, or those who live outside our cities, will say, that's enough. That can't go on like this. And that would be a major problem.
Follows that joins your question about education and online education courses. Do Mexico City and Malmo use digital solutions to make the cities more inclusive? Maybe Catherine?
Yes, we do. And we do it in different ways. We try to use digital systems in our school. For example, 50% of our pupils in schools do speak at least one other language than Swedish. And now we try to implement new techniques to have the education in different languages to make sure that you fulfill your education in different topics. Meanwhile, you're learning Swedish, for example. And we have a different way when we work with a smart city. We use technique in developing the city in a very strategical way. But when it comes to school, I think that's an important part of the development. Actually,
what about Mexico? Are digital solutions also a tool that you use maybe more often?
Sí.
Yes, we do. And in fact, now we have made headway in another sense, and I'm coming back to inclusive cities. There's a system called InclusSite, and we use that on the websites of our city for the handicapped, whom we tend to forget as well. If someone is handicapped, he needs access. If I put everything online, a handicapped may not make it to be online. So InclusSite is our system which will allow the handicapped to connect as well. And then we have the system of a doctor at home. So we have screening systems to see, for example, if someone rings and doesn't know for sure whether his son is autistic, he will connect online and we educate our citizens that way. UNESCO has the cities for training and learning cities in the double sense, learn about a city and learn within a city. How is a city also learning? All that is within the UNESCO program, and we have to set up all these mechanisms to make it possible. We were actually intending to distribute some documents about it. I think we already did, in fact. So there are all these opportunities. Like in the field of education, we set up the networks, the online conferences, the online courses. And when I was talking about 500 possibilities, many of them are such platforms. But it's not enough if I invite someone to take a course and say, well, finally, you'll get a certificate from Mexico City. That is one thing. But if I say, come and join the course, and the National University of Mexico or some well-known university will, in fact, give you a diploma. That is the big difference, and that is what we now offer, particularly to those who have less means to go to expensive places.
Wait, maybe we will hand you a microphone. That would be much easier for the audience to, and the translator.
Sorry, please speak English, Spanish. My question is for the alcalde, Miguel Ángel Mancera. Alcalde, ¿qué es lo que deja la ciudad de México?
What could Mexico City say to all these other cities? What have you learned with the other champion mayors? Mexico City is famous to be particularly polluted. You said among cities you are the 541st. You have to improve public transport. But what can you tell other cities? A city mayor is usually has a mandate of 6 years. What could you tell the other cities? A doctor at home, that's very important, yes. But you 50 champion mayors talk about many other things, urban development, sustainability. What could you offer to the others?
I believe that this OECD initiative is crucial, this call that was made to have champion mayors, and I believe it is about setting forth something that will allow all of us to interact and to pool our capabilities. I believe Mexico City will be learning a lot from all of the other mayors and from all of the other cities about what they are doing to include people and to build much more inclusive cities. And this is a huge challenge. This challenge that has been set forth by the OECD is one of the biggest challenges because it includes everything, everything a city could want. So how are we going to be doing it? That's the whole point, I believe. Because once we turn to the cities who are on the front line and in contact with people, and we stop focusing on the global level, I believe that will mean that we have made progress. I believe that there was a beacon in a meeting in the U.S. when the Secretary of State, John Kerry, welcomed mayors and had a discussion with mayors and not with country presidents. And why? Because mayors are the ones who are making these decisions. We are hands-on with full responsibility, and that is where the possibility of implementation needs to take place. And that's why it is so frustrating, because we are not part of that dialogue. We are not part of that decision making. So I think that this OECD initiative will allow us to showcase in full transparency what is sometimes concealed.
Yes, please.
Alistair MacDonald Radcliffe, the World Dialogue Council, and we have a particular interest in building social cohesion in terms of the interfaith dimension. But given our particular guest speakers at the moment, I wonder about another aspect in a very particular way. When I think of the Diocese of London and London, where I hope the new mayor will be interested in this initiative, I am very mindful of the extremity of the divide in terms of property values. In the center of the city, in Mayfair, for example, it would be impossible to buy a one-room apartment for less than $1 million. There are others at 20 million. This is very destructive of the social community because it's very divisive, and the old established communities are being driven out. It also means when it comes to employing doctors, nurses, teachers, it's impossible to bring them in and have them live there. So the practical effects are very profound, but practical solutions are hard to find. We have very different experiences internationally. Just wanted to throw out the question of what does a practical solution to that kind of housing problem look like?
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think this is a very, very interesting question. I would maybe, Catherine, yeah, first.
I think when I meet mayors from all over the world, this is a topic we do discuss a lot. A couple of months ago, during the MIPIM real estate, we had a think tank of mayors. This was the topic this year. Normally, we do debate about sustainability when it comes to environment and so on, but this time, the focus was a little bit different, more to how do we change ideas to be more successful when it comes to affordable housing. You have lots of representatives just pointing out this as the big issue. And I think when we do our city plan, one important part is to plan with different kind of housings in different kind of areas to make sure that you have apartments for rent, apartment that you are able to buy, and you have a mix of apartments for students, for young people, for families, and to make sure that you have it in the very same area. So you have a better mix than we have today. And then we work with the infrastructure to make sure that you don't have these barriers between different neighborhoods. But I think the public sector has to be very in charge and trying new ways of making buildings to a lower cost than we do today. It's a big challenge. But to make it mixed and to make sure that you have buildings that actually are affordable, even in the center, it's really high on the agenda all over.
Is that also a challenge in Mexico City?
Yes, it's the same. Yo creo que debemos.
Well, I think we need to work against this inertia. I believe that there is something in cities that just doesn't move. For instance, in Santa Fe, which is a neighborhood in Mexico City, lots of homes were built for the wealthiest inhabitants. And we are still building homes for the wealthiest people in that neighborhood. And what we need to do is have opportunity zones for service providers. For instance, university faculty can't live there because it's too expensive. Doctors can't live there, and that's where there are hospitals, because it's just too expensive. And so after working hours, that part of the city is empty because all of that population are commuters, and they go back to the other parts of the city where they live. So I believe we need to pull the city back together, and I think that is very important because in Mexico City, we did away with the practice of having rental homes, and now everyone in Mexico City purchases their home, but to get a home ownership program, then you need to show that you have income and you need to get a bank loan. And so I believe having rental housing is an important means to provide for more distribution of income and to achieve more productivity. For instance, in the government of Mexico City, we're now taking a labor-based initiative. For the government staff, we are leaving Friday afternoons off after 3 p.m. And that means that they are not on the road at the same time as everyone else. That gives them more time for their families, and they are less stressed, and they are much more productive. And now we are focusing on a pilot initiative, which means working from home, teleworking, meaning that these people would be doing what they usually do at the office, and they would have targets, but they wouldn't be at the office as much as they are now. And we hope that this will relieve some of the time they spend commuting and create better conditions so that people can ultimately live closer to where they work. We need to focus on redistributing workers. If a company only hires people that live around the company, that could be an interesting opportunity, I believe. So this is what is happening in cities. What you just told us about London, it's like trying to buy an apartment in Manhattan or in Central Park. It's impossible, and we are aware of that. But there are some zones where there are opportunities, and that is where we need mixed use areas so that people can do their shopping, can live their daily lives. And we also need more rental housing. We need to focus on homes for elderly people and for younger people. Those are the two situations we need to focus on. Otherwise, we'll have too much exclusion.
We do plan to grow and build new apartments close to different infrastructure solutions with stations and so on to reduce cost for cars, for example, to make sure that young people with no cars, and we do plan the infrastructure so it's easy to travel with the public transport. And that's a way to reduce cost for new buildings. And then we have some interesting initiatives with private land landlords that had a permission to build new apartments in an area where we have a high degree of unemployment people. And he took this initiative and he started building new apartments. Meanwhile, he's refurbing his old estate. And he's also having he signed a contract with the city to make sure that some of the unemployment in his apartments today do have some training, education, or work in his company. So we have like a holistic approach to refurbing areas today that need to be refurbed and more, with the focus also to reduce cost for energy and so. And we connect this with the permission to build new apartments and a cooperation to create more jobs. And then we do work private owners that they accept social welfare, for example, if you want to rent apartment in the city center, we would like more
to accept social welfare. Today we have a public-owned company who do accept it, and some more. And I think that's important as well, to give people a second chance.
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, we have only 15 minutes left, and I would like to come back to our poll. You know, that we ask you at the beginning of our session if you believe that you live already in an inclusive city. So I would like to ask our social media team maybe to show us the results of the poll. It's not very surprising, isn't it? So 80% think that they are not living in an inclusive city. 20% think they do. I would like to know where they live. but there's no one who said, I'm not sure about it. So this is also quite interesting. Maybe a first reaction to this poll. It's not a surprise that, and it show us then this goal of working for an inclusive city is a long-term goal. It's not the state where we already are, but it's the state that maybe one day we would like to achieve. Maybe Catherine?
Yeah. I think if you compare different cities, you have, for example, I think Malmö compared to many cities are inclusive today, but our ambitions are just, we would like it to be more inclusive than today. And you can see in different perspective when it comes to educational system, when you come to unemployment grades and so on. We have to do more, but still we are inclusive in some way. So, well, it's hard to say that. I don't think you can find a city that is all perfect when it comes to inclusion, but you have good example. And I think it's important, according to what we talked about before, to be part of networks and to be part of these global networks of cities, because I think you can, even if you're good at in some ways, you could be better if you let yourself be inspired. And I think networks like ICLE, for example, and initiatives that you presented before, it's really important. I think the people who actually plan and work in the cities, they get encouraged to spread good example, and they get good example to pick back and make it even better. So I think that's important. When it come to like COP21 in Paris last year, it was really obvious that lots of local leaders, mayors all over the world, felt very confident that even if we don't have those national agreement, we will do more together and we will help each other out. In some way, it's a competition. In some way, it's a cooperation that we do work together and compete in a good way.
Señor Miguel, what do you think? It's not a surprise, finally.
Well, it's not a surprise. De ninguna manera.
No, absolutely not. I believe that was the answer we were to expect. But it seems to be a historical trend. This is what has been building up for a very long time, and we have been generating exclusion. We have been generating differential accesses according to social classes or to categories, and now we consider this normal. We believe that if you're from an upper social class, you can have whatever you want, and there's no boundary to what you can get. You even see cards that advertise it. So yes, full access. If you're from an upper social class, you can get it. But how do we make sure that this trickles down to the levels of the population that do not have this kind of access? And it might not be as hard as we think if we all contribute to it. For instance, if we establish a public space with nice parks, with free Wi-Fi, with a society that is sharing and achieving a little bit of what other people get when they pay for it. So I believe we get more inclusive cities when this issue of access becomes a level playing field. And if we have a more inclusive city, we will have a more equal city. And now when it comes to budgets, I believe we've always spent more on wars. Look at war budgets. They're huge budgets and huge funds. And as I have said, Mexico will not be participating in any war in the near future, but we have a huge defense budget, and that should be the funds we use for social measures. And we could agree on the fact that for 1 year, for instance, the funds we use to devise nuclear weapons could be targeted at education or at providing for a much more robust society, for building up our social fabric. But this is the traditional viewpoint. So we need to make a change today because social pressure is increasing. There is more and more social pressure, and I believe the alarms are going on all over the place. And I believe that the fact that 80% of the people sitting here today are saying that their city is not inclusive, well, that means that there is something that each one of us cannot access. And that is where the barriers come up. So we can no longer be indifferent to what is going on in our social space together.
Last question, maybe from the public. Yes.
Thank you. My name is Ken Bluestone. I work for an organization called Age International. This morning at the Economic Outlook sessions, one of the important issues that all the countries are facing in the OECD was raised is the aging of the populations. And as we see a greater concentration into the cities of the majority of the world's population, the majority of the world's older people are also going to be living in these cities. This cuts across all aspects of city life, from the physical space to social barriers and responsibilities, health, education, work. But the World Health Organization has, for many years, been championing an approach to this called age-friendly cities. And I suppose I wanted to ask the OECD, to what extent are you building on this, taking into consideration the work that WHO has done in this area? And more importantly, I suppose, the mayors, how are you in your own context responding to these challenges?
Thank you very much. Maybe Mayor Steinfeld, Yamen? Yeah.
I think we work with that question in different ways when it comes to city planning, to make sure that you have an access to all public spaces, to all public services, and what we do. When we plan new apartments and so on, that we have a focus on accessibility. And at the moment, we struggle quite a lot to make sure that we can meet the need of our very, very young population with new schools, new preschools and things like that. But the challenge is to be able to give services to all categories. Even though we are growing and becoming younger and younger, we have a rising population, elderly people. So I think it's a perspective we try to use when we work with the city plan, and also when we work with traffic solutions to make them easy to access for everyone. And in some way, I feel like if we manage to build a city accessible for small children, it's also good for the elderly. I think it's if you work it with in all different perspectives when it comes to city planning, I think it's important. We try to work with it, but at the moment we struggle quite a lot to make sure that we need to meet needs of families and the very, very young population.
Thank you. Mayor Montero? Sí. Maybe a short answer?
Sí. Voy a tratar.
I'll try. There's something very important in all this. In Mexico City, we have 500,000 senior citizens who work with us. And what's the idea to give them an allowance, a food allowance to start with? then they should have possibilities to work. They should have access to credit. And they should also be able to participate in entertainment. The development is such that in the cities we'll have many more senior citizens with time passing, not only the 500,000 who are registered. And that's why I come back to our program, A Doctor at Home. If they want to exceed health services, once it's too late, it will be much more expensive. Prevention is key. And some senior citizens simply don't have what they need. Say they need a stick to walk, they don't have it. So they have different fractures and go to hospital. So they, in fact, cause a much higher expense than they would have with prevention. So we have to be aware of the fact that more than 80% of the population is concentrating in cities. And then, since life expectancy is increasing, because medicine makes a lot of progress, people will live much longer being healthy. So our cities will be populated by older citizens. So we have to prepare for it. Do we? Yes, we do. As from now already, we need special housing for them, because otherwise they couldn't live in the city. They'd be excluded. The whole system is made for them not to work, for them to have difficulty in renting a flat. Well, that's it. Yes, that's what I would say.
Very enthusiastic. Thank you for this enthusiasm. I would like to give Lamia the floor, because you won't like to do a comment, yeah, on this discussion.
Thank you very much, Achim. I think it was a very lively and very interesting discussion that I think we have addressed many of the different pillars that we have highlighted in the New York proposal. First, I'd like to respond to the question on aging. Of course, countries are at different positions. Within the work that we have been doing on inequalities in general in countries, what we found out recently that who are these new poor people, who are the one that really belongs to the top, the bottom 10%. And it appears that on average, of course, there are very different between countries, but on average, the new poor are much more the young and the children of low-income in household family. So whilst in the past, it was much more the senior. This being said, there has been a recent report produced by the OECD called Aging Inequality. It's because within this category of senior people, there are a lot of disparities. So, of course, this is a major concern. Now, we know that the question of aging is a key issue in countries like Japan. Korea is going to become maybe the first affected country very soon, and we have planned that within the 10 years, China as well. So this is something that we have been addressing at the OECD. And at the specific local level, there is a report that has been produced on aging cities that is available, that is precisely looking at this issue, how to adapt the urban planning system to these new issues. The second point I'd like to make is a reaction to the result of the poll. It was very interesting that we did that the same exercise some month ago when we released the report In It Together, so at the national level, where citizens were asked whether they feel they belong to an equal or unequal country. And what is interesting is that the results, of course, are very subjective. So it's much a matter of perception than the reality. And when we talk about perception, we talk about the level of acceptance. And when the level of acceptance reach a certain threshold, actually, we can find this type of instability in some countries, either some social movement or even worse situation that we have experienced in other countries. So I would really be interested to see, you know, which cities belong to see which are the cities that have been identified as being unequal, where maybe they are the most equal. Let's see. 3 points about the discussion, the overall discussion. The first is we have been talking a lot about inclusive cities today. We have been focusing on all these social policy-oriented actions that we have to develop and that being. But the Inclusive Growth Initiative is not a new social agenda. It's a new growth agenda. It's how to define the new economic model in a way that ex ante we take into account these issues of inequalities in access to opportunities, so that all people, all regions, all territories are endowed with the same capacity to contribute to the to growth and productivity at the same level. So this is really a growth agenda, and this is something that in the future in our work, this is something that we are going to look at. Because of course there are powerful synergies between the two objectives, inclusiveness and growth, at the local level, and we are talking about transport, housing, for instance, all the question of mobility, but there might be also some trade-off. And when there are these trade-off, what type of compensatory measures we have to take. The second point is about, I think it was the mayor of Malmo, she mentioned all this mobilization of mayors during around the issue of climate change environment, which started a long time ago. I remember I was at that moment very much involved in the things at the COP 15 in Copenhagen. Maybe it was the first time when all these mayors gathered and they were voicing for a strong climate agreement, which never came. But at least it started at that moment, and everybody started to recognize. Today, it's a given. What we observed in Paris recently, all this movement, I mean, they are recognized, they have a seat, they have a voice, but it was not the case. I think we are now, for the issue of inclusiveness, in the beginning of something that we are trying to help with this initiative, but we are not the only one, where maybe in some years, let's say in 5 to 10 years, it will be given that national government and international institution will really think that it's important to involve local actors in the debate. And this is precisely what we're trying to do. We are not here to duplicate any international association of local government. This is a place where for national government still, we are just helping to fill the gap and create a bridge between you know, what cities are doing in order to inform national government and to make sure that you know they are taking into account this very important dimension. Someone mentioned, you mentioned, I think, Mayor Mancera, that there was a meeting with John Kerry involving mayors, and this is again a testimony of this increasing importance of the role of mayors. I was also thinking about the Pope just before the COP, who convened the mayors as well. Today it's something that is not surprising, but I can tell you that 15 years ago it was really surprising. And now the cities agenda is very prominent here at the UCD, at the ministerial meeting. It's really something new, but also within the G20 agenda progressively. We are not there, of course, but very progressively. So yeah, I think it was very interesting, and thank you very much for organizing this this session.
Yes, thank you very much. Also, thank you for the audience who participate actively into the debate. We have to leave, at least we have to leave the stage and for the next debate, which is about circular economy. Thank you very much. Thank you to our speakers, Maya Mancera and Maya Sianfeld-Yame. Thank you very much, especially for your enthusiasm.